Hello. Moi moi.
Okay, thank you. It's great to be here today. So I have here with me two amazing entrepreneurs that need no introductions. So Supercell and GungHo, of course, are the two most successful gaming companies in the world. And Softbank, founded by Taizo's brother, is, of course, a big owner in Supercell. But what's also interesting is that both of these gents here have built their companies in very unconventional ways. And today we're going to discuss how they have done it. So Ilkka, first, you talk about a lot about putting people in front and center. Best people make the best games. So what does it mean in practice?
Well, basically it starts from this belief that, as everybody knows, games is a very hit-driven business. So in other words, to get a hit game, of course, you need to be also lucky, you need luck. And then the question is that if it's so much about the luck, how do you maximize the kind of a probability of success? And to us, it comes to a few basic principles. So it starts by just hiring and retaining the best people. And then once you have those best people, the question is that how do you create the best possible environment for those people to work at? And then if you have those two things in place, then with enough time and then, yes, with some luck, then the chances are that you can create a kind of great game which the users will and the players will fall into love with. And then if you are lucky enough to get that great game, then like everything else will follow. So obviously, great game isn't enough, but that has to be the starting point. So then that needs to be followed by great marketing, giving great support for your players and so forth. And if you can get all of that right, then the success, including the financial success, will follow.
Okay. So Taizo, in addition to being founder and chairman of GungHo, you are also a very active angel investor and investor. Yes. So when you look at the founding teams, how important do you think the culture and philosophy of the founders is?
If I answer that question, the culture or philosophy of the founders is the most important thing. So if I visit, when I visit the Supercell for the first time, I felt, of course, that Ilkka and their founders, co-founders' philosophy was totally, I felt sympathy for them. And also the atmosphere of the company was really good. So they still, the number of employees are 150 people, right?
Right.
Even the small, company, they're making a big movement to the world, but all the employees, their company members are kind of like a family. Yeah. So I was so impressed to watch their way of thinking and way of making games and so on. So in a sense, it was really amazing investment for us. And so I'm always looking for the new younger generation startup who has a passion and also who has a big idea. But the most important thing is a philosophy and a culture.
Okay. Yeah, I remember the special chemistry of the first visit and all the visits after that.
Yes.
Even the one when we visited Japan. So another thing, I mean, usually when you talk about startups, growth, everything is about growth and growing faster, scaling the companies. But Ilkka, you are talking about, you're saying that slow is good. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's a simple way of saying that for us, the quality is way more important than speed in itself. So, we prioritize quality above everything else. And, you know, we are trying to like constantly remind ourselves of the fact that we are trying to build something that would last for decades. And if we really are true about that statement, then what happens next month or next quarter, it actually isn't that important, that there's really no rush to get there.
But how about like both your companies, GungHo and Supercell, have, in terms of revenue and the scope, they have actually grown pretty fast. So, Taizo, what do you think? Do you agree that slow is good?
Yeah, I'd like to say that so we are not pursuing the short period profit.
Yeah.
So, for example, our Puzzle and Dragons hit, big hit was just luck only. But at the time, we are just focusing on making a good game only.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I we'd like to entertain the users who loves the gaming. So that's all we are thinking. So everybody was so interestingly watch our growth, but it's a result of the just luck.
Okay.
And we are look, instead of the pursuing the short term profit, we'd like to pursue the longer term value for the people. So okay. That's all we are thinking.
So Ilkka, do you think? I mean, have you been lucky three times with your three games, or is it just luck?
Of course, it's not just luck, but I mean, there's so many great games out there. There's so many great game developers out there, yeah. And not everybody is lucky. And of course, luck, as I said, it's an important part of the equation. Of course, you need to have extremely skilled and talented people who work super, super hard, as our guys do. So that's the starting point. But then, you know, there's no question about it. I mean, luck and you know, and most of that relates to timing, in my opinion. That's an essential part of startups and being an entrepreneur.
So what about then, like, systematic planning and strategies versus instincts? So you have both talk about trusting your instinct, but what does it mean in practice?
I think the instinct is very important thing. So sometimes I'm wondering which way to go. This is a reasonable, rational way if you think about the strategy.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
On the other hand, there is another opinion in my mind that, hey, that way is also very exciting and very hot. Then I prefer to choose that way.
Okay.
That is because so the most important thing, because the reason why I started my own company is I like to enjoy my life. So I'm not pursuing the money or profit, but very important basis my philosophy is enjoy my life.
Yeah.
So. I think the instinct means that. I'd like to choose that more exciting and fun way. So that's why. Every time I'm wandering, and then I will take on a walk. Take a walk on the wild side.
Yeah.
That is my philosophy in following instinct.
Ilkka, I know that you have ignored a lot of advice. Ignoring sometimes my advice. And breaking a lot of rules. Can you give some examples of those situations?
Right. So I'd actually like to come back to the like trusting your instincts. It's one sort of that's my actually number one advice to like any entrepreneurs who are kind of seeking advice. And my advice to those people is quite simply is that don't do as I say. Do what's best for your own company. In my opinion, it's extremely dangerous to just follow the advice of like quote successful people, and for two reasons. The first reason is that necessarily those successful people don't even know why they've been successful. And again, we just talked about luck. So the luck is so important part of the equation. Timing is so important part of the equation. So maybe it was almost entirely about that. And you know. Why the person thinks that he or she was successful, maybe that's not even true. And then second reason is that even if they did know like why they were successful, I mean, how do you know that those recipes of success are actually applicable to the situation that you're in? Maybe they come from a different industry. Certainly the time is different, the culture is different, and so forth. So. Personally, I would never ever invest into group of founders or people who just do exactly as I or some other investors say. So my advice always to new entrepreneurs is that, you know, be humble, listen to everybody, but then make the decisions yourself, and, you know, trust your instincts. And to give you some specific examples where I haven't followed your advice, we've quite constantly ignored, for example, the advices of like, hey, you need to grow quicker. It's all about scaling up fast. You know, instead we've kind of taken this very slow growth path. We're still 150 people, give or take, as a company. So that would be one example.
What about then? Like CEOs and, of course, in general, media talks about successes and companies that are doing really well. But people rarely talk about like real mistakes in public. Do you have any examples on that, like real mistakes that you have made and possibly learned something from?
Last 15 years, I made a lot of mistakes. A lot of failures. Almost over 90% of my decision or what we've done is a failure, turns into the failure. But I'd like to introduce one good example. When I started my first company, at the time I was 23 years old, and I was very young, too young, and very immature. And I founded the company with my friends university students. So at the time, because we are immature, so we sometimes struggle and we fight each other. We are too arrogant, and we can't listen to the other's advice, wise advice. So we struggled for the cash flow management. Yeah. So my first company was a system integrator. So we were working for the big companies to make information technology systems. But we couldn't maintain the stable revenue source. So that's why our company's bank account is almost zero. So I couldn't pay the salary of the next month to the employees. So I was so depressed, and I was so shocked, and so depressed. Yeah. And one day, my brother, Masa, invited me to the dinner, and hey, how's your company? And I was so down. And he gradually said hey, Taizo, you look very clear that you want me to lend them some money to survive your company. I'm not saying anything at all, but you are very clear. But you look very clear. Then, but I dare to say that I have no money to lend you. At the time, I was so shocked, but I asked why to him. And then he said that he used a very interesting, funny metaphor that the business is like playing a Super Mario. So you are like a Super Mario.
Yeah.
So you are struggling in the first stage, so you can't complete the first stage. Then I have experienced a lot before you start. So I can give you advice that, hey, you can dive into the pipeline and skip to the next stage, or you can go get on a cloud and directly go into the goal. But I can easily give you an advice, and I can, of course, I have some money to lend you if I like, but it's really not good for you. So you should experience the many failures in the first stage. Then if you have a capability to complete the first stage, then you can go to the next stage, second stage. And then if you complete the second stage and the third stage. So you should not skip the failures or experience you have to, or you should experience. So that's why I'm not giving you the money to learn. So you should experience. Hey, go back to work.
Okay.
So that was his advice. And at the time, I felt the business, the launching a startup is a very, very serious thing. So I was totally afraid of the failure. But thanks to his advice, I felt that it's like a Super Mario. Oh, wow, it's like very fun to play. So nowadays, today, I have a lot of experienced a lot of failures, but failure is my friend, and I'm still enjoying the failure, because most of the cases, we can't execute what we think ideally.
Yeah.
So we have to align with the failure. In these days, I'm enjoying the failure. Oh wow, life is very nice.
Okay, a great story. So failure is just completing levels 1, 2, and 3, and then you can start building your dream company. So what about like since probably nobody wants their company to go bankrupt. So can you design the company for failure so that you can fail but you still survive? Is it possible?
Well, I think you can certainly try to create an environment that is kind of okay with failure, actually like that embraces failure. So first of all, I think that the failure should be completely safe to fail. And then second of all, failing is completely okay as long as you fail as quickly as you can, and then you also learn something from it. And then thirdly, you need to distribute the learnings to the whole organization. So I think it comes down to two things: make the failure safe, and then to distribute the learnings from those failures.
Yeah, and I think my personal view is that entrepreneurs, good entrepreneurs, learn to manage the risks. Like they don't take any unnecessary risks, gradually by failing, they learn to design a company that survives fails.
That's the essence of the align with the failure. The risk means, I learned that risk means a manageable danger, manageable failure. So we can take a risk, but a manageable one, but we should not take a danger which we can't control. So okay. That is a very important thing to survive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But as long as we can survive, we should try everything, and lesson learned, get the lessons learned.
What about
failure.
Finally, last question? Like you guys have now worked together in partnership for more than a year. I think actually a few months more than a year. What have you learned from the partnership between a Japanese and Finnish company?
Well, I don't think it only comes down to like being a Japanese and a Finnish company. I think like fundamentally, I just think that we kind of share the same view of the world. So we have lots of similar values, like user over player first in our case, thinking about the long term, thinking that it's all about people and culture and so forth, and that really is all that kind of binds us together. Yeah. So and if those are true, I don't think it really matters if it's Japanese and Finnish companies. Although I think there's a lot of similarities between the Japanese and Finnish cultures, which probably makes it easier.
Yeah, I totally agree with Ilkka that we are sharing the values, and I respect them so much, and so mutual respect is a key to make a good relationship for a long time. And if I mention to the similarities and differences between Finland and Japan, and both two countries have an amazing the talents, which is based on the good tradition of the creating a sophisticated products or services. So we both of us we are very stick to the details. So detail is very important, to entertain the people or to make better to people to make better. Yeah. So there's no border or no country about it.
Okay, that's a great ending. Thank you, guys. We're running out of time. So a big applause to Taizo and Ilkka.
Thank you.